silence your cell phones. If you need to leave for any reason during performance, please try to do that in between pieces. Enjoy.
Thursday night, right before spring break. I just have a few things to say about this piece. I've been playing Ruth Gibbs music for about 6 years now, but this is my first time performing this particular work of hers. So it's called The Piper of Dreams, and it's based on a painting. She wrote this when she was about 20 years old, and it was inspired by a painting by a painter named Estella Canzioni, also of the same name, The Piper of Dreams. So hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
had a hairball, but he's fine. He's fine. part of the reason Dr. Carlson and I decided to do the recital this way was, although we have multiple wonderful, fabulous piano faculty here at Murray State University, they are ridiculously busy. So we decided what would happen if we tried to do a recital where we didn't need to overtax any pianists at all. So Dr. Carlson and I are both playing an unaccompanied piece. Dr. Carlson's doing some things with fixed media. Professor Webster and I have been talking about doing this piece for years. But then...
4 years.
I mean, maybe almost, because COVID got in the way first. We were going to do it in the fall of 2020, I think. I know, right? And then just when things started to get a little bit better, we were about to have people back in the recital halls, my husband and I went and had a kid. So then everything turned upside down again, and we weren't doing that. But...
I just have hairballs.
Still does. They're not from his head.
No.
So we're finally doing this, and it's so exciting. Oh, you're fine. So yes, this recital involves not overtaxing any pianists. In fact, we just got the piano off the stage because we don't need this piano.
We don't need those thinking pianos. Happy early spring break, because goodness, we all need it.
So this piece is actually originally written for flute and guitar, not clarinet and guitar. We decided to steal it because why not? Which is a super fun challenge for me because we get to do things for, like, when do I try to imitate a flute player and when do I just let it go full clarinet. And I will tell you that you'll know a couple of times when I let it go full clarinet because it almost always makes Brent chuckle.
So, fun story. I go on tour with the pep band last week and then come home with walking pneumonia. So I'm getting over that with doxycycline, which, yay, doxycycline. So forgive me if I just randomly have a laugh and a cough.
He's not contagious.
I'm not contagious. He's contagious.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Checkerboard Mesa by Philip Benstein. I've had some wonderful email exchanges with him. And he wrote this piece in 1997. He went to Zion National Park in Utah. And there's this rock formation there that has this checkerboard pattern on it. And he went there and recorded himself. He recorded nature sounds. So coyotes, crickets, frogs, but also rock sounds of some kind, also thunder and water sounds from a nearby river. So this is originally for oboe, but versions of this also exist for flute, clarinet, bassoon, horn, trombone, tuba, violin, and piano. So if you're interested in playing this, there's probably a version for you, or I bet Mr. Benstein would create one for you. This is what we call fixed media, so AKA backing track, all right? So I am gonna be playing along with this, and my favorite part about it is that I have bass cricket cues in my part. So, hope you enjoy Half Moon at Checkerboard Mesa.
Thank you. with nothing but an E-flat clarinet. This piece was actually written by Jorge Mantilla, as you can see in your program. He is currently the clarinet professor at the University of Iowa in Iowa City. But for many years, he was the E-flat clarinetist of the Caracas Clarinet Quartet from Caracas, Venezuela. And more personally, he was my first E-flat clarinet teacher. I was an undergrad in Indiana, and I got assigned to play E-flat in, I think it was the Music Man? I don't remember. But I went upstairs to the fifth floor, and I checked out an E-flat clarinet, and I immediately went to find Jorge and say, it's so tiny, I don't, what do I do, help. So it's kind of come full circle that now I'm playing a piece that he wrote when he was the first person who helped me with this nonsense. So, the title loosely translates to the voice of the little bird, and it is quite small, but it sounds maybe a little bit more like that bird that blows up in Shrek, you know, when she sings to it. It's a good time. I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
find a piece for bassoon and fixed media. That's literally what I put through YouTube. And I found this. It's called Disco Ball by Russell Brown, and I've had a lot of fun. And it's my hope that my intent is to take this and play it for area high school musicians in the hopes of inspiring more people to play the bassoon, that sometimes it can be cool, or at least it can try to be cool, maybe a little. Just a couple notes to make sure we're working out here. All right, Disco Ball is a go. Tucson, Arizona, who is watching on the live stream. So hello, Kincaid.
Hi, Kincaid.
And this piece is for flexible instrumentation. So the official title is Chasing Monarchs, A Summer's Afternoon for Oboe and English Horn, but it can be adapted for oboe and clarinet, soprano saxophone and clarinet. So that's all going to be available if people are interested in it. And I have some program notes that Kincaid sent me that I would like to share with you. Chasing Monarchs. The monarch butterfly flutters through fields and flowers throughout the continental United States, easily recognizable by the lattice of orange and black that decorates their wings. Monarch butterflies have captured the imagination of generations. Chasing Monarchs depicts an idyllic summer picnic in a golden meadow with babbling brook and whistling wind. As monarch butterflies rise on gusts that tickle the meadow grass, children run and play, and all troubles melt into distant memory. So this piece showcases everything that I love about Kincaid's music. They are just a masterful storyteller, and really, really brilliant in how they depict various scenes and emotions and memories. So we'll take a quick tuning note, and then I hope you enjoy the world premiere of Chasing Monarchs.